It's a great pleasure to be here today and to see so many friends that I've known and who've also contributed so much to our understanding of China and other parts of East Asia. The introduction made absolutely clear, I've been working on this project for 10 years, and I do regard Deng as the person in the 20th century who probably had more impact on the shaping of the 21st century than any other leader. And when I was retiring in 2000, thinking about what I wanted to work on, this seemed like the obvious topic. There were several big books on Mao. There were one or two little ones on Deng Xiaoping, including one by Richard Evans, the former British ambassador to Beijing. But it's a very brief book and goes mostly up before 1949. And I felt that Deng deserved some major work. And one of the fortunate things about being on the faculty at Harvard is you have a chance to meet a lot of people and to use all the connections. Can I hear well enough?
Turn it up just
a bit. Turn it up a little bit, okay. Okay, hopefully this will be a little clearer in the back. That I wanted to use all the connections that I had, all the library resources, and work as hard as I could to try to figure out what kind of person this was. I was debating in the early years of the work whether to make it primarily a biography or whether to focus it more on the years in which he transformed China. Some of the reviewers have complained that I didn't spend enough time talking about Deng before 1969. And in the end, that was my deliberate choice and also the advice of the Harvard Press. It was going to be a long book, and rather than just focus on him as a person, I wanted to try to understand his background so you have a sense of what kind of person he is, but I wanted to focus on the way in which he tried to go about changing China. Those of you who worked on Mao Zedong know that before 1949, he had no experience abroad, and that one of the great differences between Deng and Mao was that Deng did have an important experience abroad and was much more deeply involved in the West and had a much deeper understanding of the developments around the world, so that while Mao never quite outgrew the desire to keep making revolution, Deng already had a conception of a country that would modernize and join the modern world. What I want to do today is focus primarily on the foreign relations part of the book. I apologize to those of you who've read it already or gone through it in much more detail that I'll be repeating, of course, some of the things I said in the book. But maybe what you can think of today is an effort to highlight what I think are some of the more important aspects of how he got interested in the foreign countries, what his own experiences, what he brought to it, and the nature of his relations with foreign countries. The first picture we have of Deng Xiaoping is when he was 16 years old in France. We don't have any pictures of him before that time. When he was 15, his father heard about opportunities for talented young people from Sichuan, the province he came from passing examinations and getting a year of special training in Chongqing to go and spend some time in France. And before that time, the Chinese had already decided that at that time period, World War I, that the country they most wanted to go to was France, unlike after 1978 when Deng came to power and the interest was primarily in coming to the United States. And of course, after 1978, the Chinese students going abroad had the benefit of many scholarship programs. But at the time of 1919-1920, there were basically no such scholarship programs. And so many people in China conceived the idea will send students abroad to work part-time and earn enough money so that they could attend university while they're going abroad. Unfortunately, the people who conceived this program didn't have enough sense of what the changing world economy would be. for they made the decisions during World War I, and there was a prominent Sichuan business person who put up money that became the basis for 84 students from Sichuan going abroad, all of whom had passed the appropriate examinations. But by the time they got to France, it was 1920, the French soldiers who survived the war were coming back to work. The capitalists were exploiting the workers. The workers who were native Frenchmen had very poor pay and did very tedious work, but the foreigners who were there had even poorer jobs. So when they started having discussions among the Chinese students and little study groups in the early 1920s, one of the things that they studied was the Russian Revolution, which was just fresh in their minds, occurred in 1917. And as they began to study it, the framework that they read about of capitalists exploiting workers and of imperialist countries exploiting those from other countries made absolute sense to what they were doing. And so we have here a picture in 1924 of Deng Xiaoping and some of his fellow Chinese students. There were over 1,500 Chinese students in France at the time. Some people say that Deng was 5 feet tall. Others say he was only 4 feet 11. He's here on the back bench. When President Carter met him, he commented that many of the Russians seemed to try to prove that they were upbeat and modern. And with Deng Xiaoping, he said, there was never any problem like that. You just got down to business right away. So not only was he confident with the Chinese civilization, but his size never seemed to bother him. In the course of the Chinese Revolution, these people did not necessarily play a key role. But after 1949, when they were building foreign policy, science and technology, building up the economy, these people who had experience in France were to play a key role. Deng was there for 5 years in France, 1920-25. If you look at this picture, they don't look like they came right off the ghetto streets. Maybe some of them borrowed suits for the picture, but it's obvious they are identifying with the vanguard. They were the intellectual leaders who would be leading the workers and peasants, organizing the workers and peasants, and the work that they were doing was very much like what ordinary laborers did, but that they were, even though they didn't have a chance to go to the universities, they did have a chance to observe things on the streets. It's remarkable that after 1949, in dealing with science and technology and foreign relations, economics, these people played a very key role. One of the people who had gone to France, Chen Yi, had already gone back home earlier and later became mayor of Shanghai and foreign minister. In the front row, of course, in the middle, you have Zhou Enlai, who was about 6 years older than Deng. Deng was born in 1904, Zhou was born 6-7 years earlier. He was already the natural leader of this group. He had been to Japan and England and had a much deeper understanding of what a communist movement might be. But at the left, you see in that same group is Nie Rongzhen, who later played a key role in science development, particularly in defense-related science. And you see Li Fuchun, who played a very key role economics. These people were smart enough to know not to form a French clique. If they had formed a clique, they would have been batted down because it was an effort to get unity at the top. But they nevertheless felt a certain kind of attachment to each other and an easy understanding, and that at key points in Deng's history, the first time when he was removed in Jiangxi, it was Li Fuchun and Li Fuchun's wife who helped rescue him. So there was a kind of a feeling of camaraderie among these people, even though they could not form a clique. From 1949 to 52, Deng was in charge of the Southwest. But in 52, he came to Beijing, and he already became active in foreign affairs. And of course, at that time, from 52 through the early 1960s, the key places that they met people were other communist parties. And particularly after the Eighth Party Congress in 1956, when Deng was general secretary of the party, as a party leader, his responsibility was for meeting people from communist parties elsewhere in the Soviet Union, Eastern Europe. So he met many Soviet leaders. Here, in 1957, Mao made a famous speech in Moscow that the east wind would prevail over the west wind. And he pointed to some little guy in the corner and said, "Watch that guy, he's got a great future." That, of course, was Deng Xiaoping. One of the ways I think about Deng is somewhat like somebody in Washington, D.C. analogy would be, early in the 20s, they got to work in the White House and were close enough to the president, they had a sense of what the key issues were that the White House was thinking about and how they thought about them. And then stayed in Washington and for 20, 30 years had a very keen sense of all the big national issues as seen by the top leaders. That was very much how Deng was, because he, early in the 1950s, he was already considered one of the leading candidates to be successor to Mao, and he was very close to all the decision makings. Here, Deng is in Moscow in 1960 with Khrushchev. Just 4 years before this, in 1956, Deng had gone to Moscow at the time of the famous 20th Party Congress when Khrushchev denounced Stalin. And Deng was already head of that political section of that delegation. Zhu Deng was the official leader. But for political issues, Deng already had responsibility. And in 1956, he could see how the devastating criticism that Khrushchev made of Stalin affected all those who were working closely with Stalin. And nearly every leader was implicated. And that very much weakened the authority of the party. And he was very determined from that time on that if there should be criticisms of Mao, we should not do it in such a way that it would overwhelm the authority of the party. He met, of course, a lot of communists from other places. Ho Chi Minh had been in France when he was in the 20s, and they didn't really become acquainted in the 20s. But in this period, when they were still fighting imperialism, and of course, later, he was very close to Vietnamese leaders until the American bombing of Vietnam made Vietnam dependent on modern technology and defenses against American bombing, which could only come from the Soviet Union. And the Soviet Union used that to get Vietnam to tilt more toward the Soviet Union than to China. But here in these early days, he was still very close to people like Ho Chi Minh. In the early 1960s, there were, as many of you know, an exchange of 9 letters with the Soviet Union when China was very critical of developments in the Soviet Union. And the man that Mao put in charge of those was Deng Xiaoping. Deng Xiaoping, after the 5 years in France, spent 1 year in the Soviet Union. And that was from January 26 to January 27. And those of you who know about the United Front period from 23 to 27 realize that it was only April 27 when the nationalists, Chiang Kai-shek, split off from the communists and began killing them. Until that time, they were working together. So Deng was in Moscow at the same time that they were had a United Front. And he was put in a special group called the Theory Group. And another member of that same group at that time was Jiang Jingguo. Jiang Jingguo, the son of Chiang Kai-shek, who was then in the Soviet Union, was during the United Front, and they were in the same theory subgroup in Moscow. But anyhow, in the early 60s, Deng was very much in charge of the letters criticizing the Soviet Union. And in 1963, here he is going off to Moscow. to debate with Sislov in the final breaking of those relationships, the ending of the letters, and the breaking down of relationships with the Soviet Union. And I don't know about your impression from this picture, but as I see it, Deng didn't look like he was modest or suffering from an inferiority complex. He seems to be walking with a good bit of confidence as he was seen off at the airport by Liu Shaoqi, Peng Zhan, and others, Zhou Enlai, as he went off to Moscow in 1963 for those arguments with Sislov. Then, of course, in 1966, Deng was criticized in the Cultural Revolution, and he was out of it until 1973. From 69 to 73, he was down in the countryside at Jiangxi, where he had an opportunity to think about the big issues and about what he would do if he came back to power. He returned to Beijing in 1973, this is after the death of Lin Biao, about a year and a half after, that Deng was allowed to return to Beijing. And the first occasion he showed up was at a dinner that Zhou Enlai gave for Sihanouk. And here Deng is at that dinner, first time back after the Cultural Revolution, acting as if nothing happened, he'd just gone back to work. This to me is a very poignant picture. Until about 1973, Zhou Enlai was the key person who was managing foreign affairs. And he had been, of course, the key person that Kissinger met. And we know now that Mao was getting upset that Zhou Enlai was too soft on the United States and his meetings with Kissinger, and wanted Deng to begin to see foreigners instead of Zhou Enlai. At the same time, Zhou Enlai was beginning to suffer from cancer. This is 74. Zhou Enlai is already a bit emaciated. He died in January 76. But here is Zhou Enlai, who deserved, in a way, the chance to give China's speech at the United Nations, seeing off his younger comrade and understudy, Deng Xiaoping, who would go to the United Nations and make mainland China's maiden speech to the General Assembly. Only in 1971 did Beijing replace Taiwan for the China seat in the United Nations. So mainland China was new, and this speech was therefore a very important event. Here's Deng making a speech. Here he is at the podium. While he was in New York, he had his first meeting with Kissinger. During the earlier visits of Kissinger and, of course, Nixon, Deng was out of the ballgame. He was criticized by the Cultural Revolution, and from 69 to 73, he was down in Jiangxi. So he had never met Kissinger until this visit. Kissinger, and on the left, of course, is Chia Guanhua, the foreign minister at the time, who Deng, all the difficult question Deng passed on to Chia Guanhua. Kissinger said that it seemed like Deng Xiaoping was on a training mission. I think that's a little unkind. The Deng was already much better informed about foreign affairs than that. But it is true that Zhou Enlai, for several decades, had been in charge of foreign affairs and could engage in a broad tour of the horizon the way that Deng could not. But I think perhaps even more important at that time, Deng knew that Mao was very volatile. He was very cautious about saying anything that might get him in trouble with Mao. So he was very cautious and didn't seem very confident, and I think a striking contrast to how he behaved after Mao's death. Now, at the end of 75, Deng again went criticism. Mao had a special regard for Deng. He had a high opinion, but on two occasions he purged him, and I think that he wanted to make it clear that he was in charge and Deng should follow him very closely. But he never completely eliminated Deng the way he did Liu Shaoqi and some of the other officials. It was as if he had enough regard for this person that he thought that maybe he could come back and play a major role. Well, so Deng was purged for the second time in early 1976. Mao dies in September. And the question is, should Deng be allowed to come back? and those discussions proceed. And in the summer of 1977, Deng was allowed to come back. But Hua Guofeng, whom Mao had named as his successor, was still very much in charge. So Deng volunteered that when he came back, he said there are two ways of thinking about it. One is just to be fill an office. The other is to get something done. I want to get something done. And he chose to focus. He volunteered to work on education, science, technology, which he thought was the most important for China's takeoff and for the modernization, which would then begin. It was a year after Mao's death, and they would begin the drive for modernization. And Deng felt especially that science and technology was very important. So he called together about 3 or 4 days after he came to back to work already, the education group around Beijing, including the education minister. And Deng asked them if they could begin to have entrance examinations that year and reopen the universities, which had basically been shut down for about a decade. They told him all the problems of reopening. There would be about 7 million or so people who would be taking examinations. They would have to decide on the subjects they would be examined on. Some people would have to make up the examinations, plan for the administration examinations, plan for the grading of 7 million reports, and then make the decision on who would be allowed to enter the university, and then get the universities to reopen in various subject matters. Some of you who have had experience in university administration know that that's quite a bit to accomplish in universities in a period of 3 or 4 months. And after all the problems, Deng says, is it possible we could do it this year? And the education minister says, it is possible. Deng says, we're going to do it. And so he moved right ahead. And the students who were allowed to come back and take examinations were very thankful to Deng that he now people could get into the universities on the basis of merit. And they feel they owe a lot to Deng. Deng had almost a magical belief in the importance of science. The woman he married in Yunnan, Zhuo Lin, in the 1930s was one of the few women of her generation to finish the number one women's high school in Beijing and to get into universities. Almost no women, of course, went to universities in those days. Not only did she go to the university, but she majored in physics at Beijing University. Now, Deng has 5 children. One of them was too sickly to study science, and so Deng Lin, the oldest one, and she went into art and music. One of them went into medicine. 3 of them went into physics, both boys, and one of the girls went into physics. I think that gives some idea of how Deng felt about the importance of science, how critical it was for modernization. So after he came to power began to come back in 1977, one of the ways he could learn about science and technology was by getting the Chinese Americans who had distinguished themselves in science to come and give some kinds of advice. He felt that they could not only speak Chinese, but they knew the situation in China, knew where China was at. A lot of these people had been in China until the late 1940s and only stayed in the West after 1949. But some of them had even visited China before that time, and Deng went to them for advice. At that time, there were 3 Chinese Americans who had won the Nobel Prize. Deng wanted to talk to all of them. Here he is meeting Yang Jianning, one of the Nobel Prize winners. Here he is meeting Samuel Ting of MIT, one of the Nobel Prize winners. And here he is meeting Li Zhengdao and his partner Li Yuanzi, the other Nobel Prize winners. So Deng saw all these people, and he saw them a number of times. He wanted to know what it was China needed to do to modernize its science so that could provide the basis of modernization. He also met a lot of other people Chinese Americans of distinguished academic background. I show this one partly because, not only because Jiao Yunren is such a well-known linguist, but because his daughter over there to the right was a Chinese language teacher, and she was my first Chinese language teacher, and she was a tough son of a gun. I think a biographer has the responsibility for trying to be honest and not overpraise the subject of his topic. A lot of the official history reads as if Deng became the preeminent leader in December 1978, and that he then led modernization by starting with reform and opening. I think it's not quite fair to Hua Guofeng, who was beginning much of that opening before that time. And particularly, I think it neglects the key role of the missions that were going abroad to learn about the foreign situation. And none of those delegations abroad had the impact of the Gumu delegation that went in May 1978. I believe this delegation has not received the attention it should from Western scholars, because when I talk to high-level Chinese leaders who were involved in things at that time, they always point to this key delegation. Gu Mu had been head of the Construction Commission. He had been vice premier. He had been in what the Chinese called the Ye Wuzhu, the group that was responsible for trying to administer the basic functions of the economy throughout the Cultural Revolution. Even while most people were off making revolution, there was a small group called the Ye Wuzhu with Zhou Enlai and Gu Mu and others, who Li Xianyan, who were concerned about keeping the economy going. And Gu Mu was one of those key people. And so when he was selected in 1978, he was allowed to take with him the leaders in various ministries and in various provinces, people concerned with key economic issues and key sectors, who would have a chance in a 5-week visit to Europe. They went to Switzerland, Germany, France, Belgium, and Holland. And during that 5 weeks, they split up according to their own specialty and visited various factories, mines, agricultural stations, seaports, to have a sense of what modern technology really amounted to. Those of you who worked on Japan know that in way back in 1871, there was a famous Iwakura mission that went abroad for 21 months and that played such a key role in providing direction for Japan's modernization beginning the Meiji period. But this group came back and they were to have a report one afternoon, and the report was to last perhaps 2 or 3 hours. The meeting went on for 9 hours. And they were just shocked to hear how advanced Europe had become, how completely it had surpassed China. But what was encouraging was that the foreigners were now ready to lend them money and provide technology, so that after all the propaganda about the horrible capitalists, imperialists who hated China, they just found out that that didn't characterize the Europe they saw, and that there were a lot of opportunities out there. And so that provided a very large change of climate in Beijing, so that when Deng assumed the preeminent position in December, there was already very considerable preparation for the basic ideas. Of course, they didn't have any concrete things to do. It would take a while, but they had a new, very different direction. Here Deng is talking to Gu Mu. Those of you who studied the history in 1978 know that the Central Party Work Conference was the key work conference that decided that Hua Guofeng was not up to the job of providing the top leadership. Some of my Chinese friends say he was a tu baozi, that he was really a hick. I think that's not fair. But I do think it could be characterized as Xiangji Ganbu. You know, he was a provincial level official of quite pragmatic and didn't do such a bad job. One thing I quote in my book is, in going through various papers, I came across a report that the American head of the consul of the liaison office in Beijing had written in early 76. It went out under the name of Thomas Gates, who was head of the liaison office at that time. And that this was early 1976, just after Mao had named Hua Guofeng to high position, so it seemed as if he was going to be the successor. And Thomas Gates wrote back, he seems very pragmatic, very sensible. He seems easy to work with. He seems amiable, able to get along with people. But he doesn't seem to have the high ability and the determination to be a really top leader. He probably would make a good transitional leader, and before long, probably some stronger leader would come by and take over and bring in a stronger policy and move ahead further. Of course, that turned out to be remarkably prescient. That was the description in early 1976, and that basically described the transition that was going to take place in the next couple of years when Deng was the stronger leader. However, the top leaders at the time were so upset that Mao had so dominated things during the Great Leap Forward and the Cultural Revolution that one person could dominate so much by having all the top positions that there was no structure for people who had other ideas to get them in and to limit Mao. And they wanted to create a new structure after Mao that would not allow one person to become so completely dictatorial. So Deng Xiaoping was never called premier. He was never called chairman. And in addition, when he took over at the third plenum, which took followed immediately after that meeting, he was paired with Chen Yun, who was the only person in China that time who had comparable respect of large numbers of high officials. He was 1 year younger than Deng, and for about 20 years was even higher in his position. Played not only a key role in the overcoming inflation 1949-52 and in setting up the first five-year plan, but way back in Yan'an he had been in charge of personnel. And since that time he knew a lot about personnel issues. So he was seen as the one person who was strong enough to provide some kind of balance to Deng. As I followed the years afterward, the way I think about it is this, that in the United States, if you talk to people at the White House and the State Department, you know, officially they agree on everything and we're always completely unified. There are no important differences. But if you get down to the ground floor day after day, they're talking about how they're going to fight the guy at the other place. I think that is a fair characterization of the politics within the high-level leadership. There was no other person except Chen Yun who was high enough who could be a real counter to Deng. And so a lot of the people who didn't want to go so fast, who thought they ought to be more careful, who thought that they shouldn't open so much to the Western countries, they went to Chen Yun. And Chen Yun was therefore in a position to provide some balance. They never publicly criticized each other, but all the people inside the government knew that they had very, in the high party circles, knew that they had very different perspectives. 2 months before that, as Deng was getting ready, let me go back a few months before that. In early 1978, as Deng thought about the modernization that would take place after Mao, he realized that the two countries they would need most for their cooperation in building was Japan and the United States. Japan had a lot of industrial technology. They would give some reparations. They had good quality control. They were nearby, and they could learn a lot from Japan. He knew that he had, in going to Japan, he would have to face two ways. He would have to convince the Japanese that China was sufficiently stable, that it was now all right to make investments, and that would not be appropriated right away. He also had to convince the Chinese that they could learn from Japan. As you know, many people felt that Nixon was able to open to China politically because he was such a strong anti-communist, that if the Democrats had taken that step, they would have been very vulnerable for being too weak on communism. In the same way, Deng, who had been a guerrilla fighter who from 1937 to 1945 had been on the front lines fighting the Japanese for 8 years, was in a very strong political position to say, look, we have to work with these people. In the 2,500 years in which Japan and China had some kind of contact, the top Chinese leader had never gone to Japan. No high-level official had ever met the Japanese emperor. Here is this visit in 1978, where the emperor apologized to Deng for World War II and said, we should never let this happen again. And Deng accepted the apology and was ready to convey back to China that we can work with these people. During his visit to Japan, he visited a number of factories. Here he is at the Kimitsu steel plant, one of the most modern plants that became the model, was already becoming the model for the first modern steel plant in China at Baoshan in Shanghai. As you know, for over a century, there have been a lot of people who fawned on the West and said how wonderful it was. And there are a lot of patriots who were furious. And of course, Mao's wife, Jiang Qing, had jumped on a lot of political leaders for fawning on the West. And Deng took the first ride on the bullet train. At that time, China had no bullet trains. As you know now, China probably has more mileage of bullet trains than any country in the world. But at this time, Deng rode the bullet train for the first time. And when he was asked by a Chinese reporter, what about that ride on the bullet train? Deng said, it's very fast. What that conveyed was, I'm not stooping down. I'm not saying they had advanced and they were way ahead of us and they could do a lot of things that we couldn't do. And we're so sorry and we're so appreciative. But he recognized that there were a lot of things to learn from the West. While he was there, he went around to see Tanaka Kakui. And he said, when one drinks water, of course they weren't drinking water at that time, they were drinking something else. When one drinks water, one thinks of who made the well in the first place. And the person who normalized relations between Japan and China was Tanaka Kakue. And just because he was under house arrest for the Lockheed scandal, Deng still wanted to see him, and so here he is at Kakui under house arrest at his home, drinking and thanking him for his contribution for Sino-Japanese relations. The next month, Deng was in Southeast Asia, and among the people he saw was Lee Kuan Yew, about 25 years younger. I think I had a chance to interview Lee Kuan Yew about Deng, and Lee Kuan Yew considers Deng perhaps the greatest leader that he met, because he said, he recognized the situation, he recognized that the system that he grew up in was no longer working, and he was eager to learn the new system. When Carter became president in 77, he was determined to move ahead with normalization. He first sent Vance, and he wasn't quite ready at that time, but in May 1978, he sent Zbigniew Brzezinski with the message, we're ready to begin negotiations on normalizations. Zbigniew's father was a Polish diplomat. Deng Xiaoping had fought against the Soviet Union in the early 1960s in all those battles, and they saw eye to eye perfectly on the Soviet Union, and they were companions for beginning normalization. President Carter wrote in his diary that when Zbigniew returned, he was so infatuated with Deng Xiaoping that he had to say, look, hold it. He was teasing Zbigniew for being so completely taken. But Zbig said, and he wrote later, that he instantly liked Deng Xiaoping. They hit it off. They were crisp discussions. He was bright. He was quick. You could carry on real meaningful conversations. And so they made a deal that when Deng came to Washington, if he ever came to Washington, the first night he would have dine at Zbig's house, and indeed he did. Here, Leonard Woodcock was sent to be head of the liaison office in Beijing by Carter because he was an outstanding negotiator who would, had been respected both by labor and management, even though he was a labor leader. But Woodcock also had a lot of friends in Washington, and Carter figured that all the difficult issues of getting Congress to go along with agreements would be much easier if Woodcock were the one who carried on the discussions. Most of the discussions over normalization over several months were carried on by Chinese diplomats and by Woodcock. But in the last part of the negotiations, Deng himself took part, and here he is with Woodcock congratulating each other on the achievement of normalization. When Deng was asked at that time by the American government, that they would like to invite some Chinese leader, the American government was being very cautious because Hua Guofeng was still president, he was still a chairman of the party, and it wasn't clear whether it would be Hua Guofeng or Deng who would come. And so when Woodcock conveyed that message to Deng, Deng said, yes, we will send someone next month, and I'm ready to come. He made it clear that he was the one. Some of you may have met Ji Chaozhu, the interpreter, who was a student at Horace Mann in New York in 48 to 1950, a student at Harvard University, who was not only a superb linguist, but had a very deep understanding of America and American politics. His college roommate freshman year was a guy named Herb Levin, who was in the State Department working for Kissinger at the time. So he's the one who conveys the translation between the two, interpretation. Here we are waving from the White House. Here they are signing the normalization agreement that had been reached with Woodcock and Deng the month before. And just as Deng wanted to see Tanaka Kakue in Japan, so he wanted to see the guy who dug the wells of Chinese-American relations in the United States. Nixon was had been thrown out after Watergate, but Deng insisted he be invited to the White House when he's there, and so Carter allowed Nixon to return. First time he came back to the White House after he was thrown out after Watergate. You see Deng there around the middle of the picture, and the tall guy, Ji Chaozhu, the interpreter, standing there. And to Ji Chaozhu's right is an old white-haired guy, Tip O'Neill, the Speaker of the House. Tip and O'Neill and Deng then had a long conversation. And during that conversation, Tip O'Neill regaled Deng with stories of how Congress was fighting the White House. And they really hit it off, and the next year, at Deng's invitation, O'Neill went to Beijing. But during at the end of this conversation, as O'Neill was stressing how important it is to have two separate bodies, the legislature and the White House, executive at the White House, then Deng finished the conversation by saying, wouldn't work in China. He wanted a single party at the top with no split that could unify what was going on. During Deng's tour of about 10 days in the United States, he visited Atlanta, Carter's home, and visited a Ford Foundation, a Ford factory. Here we're getting ready for the famous picture. He was at a rodeo in Texas, and here's a lady rides up on a horse and hands Deng a hat, a cowboy hat. And here Deng is putting on the hat. This is the picture that was perhaps best known of all the pictures of Deng Xiaoping in the United States. And it endeared Deng to Americans. He could be just one of us. And Orville Schell, who's a very knowledgeable journalist, was Dean of Journalism at one point, University of California, Berkeley, was at this session and said, it was also as if, and the movies made of this played in China, that Deng was no longer accepting that America was a lousy imperialist country, but it was okay to imbibe American culture, American art, American life. It was now okay, and this picture seemed to symbolize that new spirit for the Chinese public. Here is Deng meeting with Bush Sr. It happened that during 1975, when Mao was still alive, Deng had the major responsibility as deputy premier for running the country. He and Wang Hongwen were sort of in charge of things during 1975. And during that year, the person who was head of the liaison office in Beijing, American liaison office, was Bush Sr. So they saw each other a lot during that year and became quite close. Now, in the negotiations over normalization, Deng was informed that America insisted on continuing to have arms sales to Taiwan. We would stop for 1 year, 1979, but would resume again. But it wasn't clear that that was going to take place. And finally, Deng agreed that they would go ahead with normalization, even though that was a problem. But after 1979, he kept pushing the United States to limit arms sales and was threatening to downgrade and even break relations with the United States if we sold them too many arms. So Bush Sr., this is early in the Reagan administration, vice president, went to Beijing and negotiated with Deng, and they agreed to limit arms sales to Taiwan. And that they didn't have the diplomats on both sides work out the details of the negotiation, which became the third communique in August 1982, which did place limit on arms sales from the United States to Taiwan. You see what Reagan had to say after he met Deng. And when he first was coming to office, he was talking as if we ought to have normal relations with Taiwan and treat it as a country, and which greatly upset the Chinese. But Bush Sr.'s visits to Beijing put that back on track, enabling Reagan to go and visit with Deng, and you can see they got along quite well. It's quite remarkable as you think about this series of pictures that Deng hit it off, you know, not only with the Democrats, but Republicans of various persuasions. And here he is talking with Thatcher about the return of Hong Kong and making it clear that China expected to retake Hong Kong in 1997 when the lease ended. And I think what's significant is not only negotiations, but Deng decided that he would try to send apprentice people to Hong Kong to have them learn about Hong Kong so that in the 15 years before the reversion of Hong Kong to mainland rule, they would prepare a lot of people for different positions and that they would be well prepared. Deng, as an administrator, unlike Mao, who was a philosopher and often behind the scenes and could talk about poetry and history, Deng was the administrator. He was the person on the front line managing details, and he therefore wanted to have people ready to take over. And training successors was always a very key part of Deng's approach. Deng also was very strong in getting China into international organizations. He liked the World Bank because it didn't represent any single country. And Deng was very anxious to get China into the World Bank, and the World Bank played a very key role in the modernization of China. Deng also wanted to get into other organizations. Here he is seeing the head of IMF. Some of you know Frank Gibney, who came from this area, and who did a wonderful job of educating people and making films. And some of you are old enough to remember the days before Google and the days before Wikipedia. And you try to think how you get world knowledge at that time in 1978. Well, the Encyclopedia Britannica was one of the key way of getting some of the basic knowledge about the world translated into Chinese. And Frank Gibney, as Vice President of Encyclopedia Britannica, is here negotiating with Deng to get the Encyclopedia Britannica in Chinese so the Chinese could be much better informed. Deng, of course, met a lot of other foreign business people, including Hong Kong Chinese leaders. Some of you have gone to the White Swan Hotel in Guangzhou. A lot of Americans who were adopting Chinese kids met their kid in the White Swan Hotel where they were brought in to be adopted. And this was put up by Henry Falk, who had received a lot of favors from mainland and was therefore happy to make the donation of the hotel. He's seeing Hong Kong billionaire Li Ka-shing. I've gone through the records of the meetings as much as I could. One of the best sources for anybody working on high leaders in China is what the Nianpu, the chronologies they put out on major leaders. And I've gone through Deng's chronology, the Nianpu, with great care. And I don't recall ever seeing that he met a foreign economist. He met business people and scientists. He met reporters. He particularly liked people who'd been in charge of things, who'd run things. That was the kind of person he admired and could talk to. Here he is learning about computers from another Chinese-American, An Wang. Here he is meeting with Bush in 1989. Here in the after the big split, after Deng went to argue in the Soviet Union in 1963 with Syslov, the relation between China and Russia are basically in cold storage from 63 until the 80s. Deng felt in the 1980s that, early 1980s, that if they could get Russia to agree to three conditions, pulling out of Afghanistan, pulling their troops back from Mongolia, and getting Vietnam to pull out of Cambodia, that then that would be the basis for normalizing relations with the Soviet Union. And in 1989, Gorbachev was willing to meet those conditions and came to Beijing under Deng's conditions. And that was, of course, the reason so many foreign reporters were on hand when the democratic demonstrations began. The demonstrations grew very large. They had a lot of support from the Beijing public. Here is the famous goddess of democracy based on the Statue of Liberty. Here, Deng decided that it was too risky, that they needed to regain order, that when the troops went in May 20th and could not keep order by not firing arms, that they had no choice but to go in fully armed. And here they are bringing order to the city, the famous picture with the man standing in front trying to stop the tanks. Bush Sr., who was president by this time, I'm sorry, this was not dispatched by Reagan, that's a mistake. It was dispatched by Bush, who was president at that time. I'm sorry, that my assistant made a mistake there. But Brent Scowcroft was sent to Beijing because Bush felt it was very important to establish good relations and keep relations, that even though we were enforcing a lot of sanctions, it was so difficult to have relations with China, it was very important. And Bush said it was partly because of his personal relationship with Deng that he came to that decision, it was so important. And he sent Brent Scowcroft to keep that thing alive. After 1989, Deng said, we must keep calm, calm, calm. I enjoy swimming in the wide ocean. It was as if, don't get too excited. The wide ocean is still there, is going to be there for years ahead. Foreign business people don't have a long memory. Before a few years, they're going to be wanting to get into the Chinese market. They'll talk to their governments. So don't get too excited. Just remain calm. And the foreign countries will come back. I think you'd have to admit that he had a rather accurate assessment of what the situation would be after a few years. By 1992, Deng, age 88, was finally ready to leave. Here he is giving full support after his southern journey when he pushed China to further opening and to faster growth, waving goodbye to the party and stepping down finally from all active role in the party. Here he is up front. It seems to be a very poignant picture. Is waving goodbye as he stepped down. The next several years, Deng was basically cultivating his garden. In 1997, he passed away at age just 93. And here is the gathering at his funeral. Here is Jiang Zemin giving the memorial speech. And here is the Security Council, which had a moment of silence for Deng's death. Since Deng had given the inaugural speech of a Chinese leader to the UN in 1974. Thank you very much.